free market Republican operative in Washington D.C., head of the Americas for Tax Reforms. He joins approximately 150 people attend each morning, each Wednesday morning for an hour and a half. And it's like a fast news program. Each of the persons who participates in that event speaks just for 1 minute, 1 minute and a half of what they are doing in favor of freedom. And it's a great way to get to know each other, to focus on the good, on the positive. And we have been doing for the last year and a half, the first Wednesday of each month in Washington, D.C., we do an international coalition meeting. So if any of you are in Washington the first week of each of a month, or if you want to participate by Skype, please let me know. And we really enjoy calling think tankers from all over the world so they can tell us what is going on at their institute and in their particular countries. We have a nice group of people today. I will moderate and we'll give 2 or 3 minutes to each. And I will not introduce them because they are well known and they will say a few things about themselves when they come here. I will start then with Morton Blackwell from the Leadership Institute in the United States. Morton.
Thank you very much, Alex, and I appreciate the opportunity to address you all very briefly. I could mention that some years ago, Atlas had a meeting in Charlottesville, Virginia. My wife and I have had for decades a weekend house in the mountains, the Blue Ridge Mountains nearby. And I contacted the folks at Atlas and said, I'm going to come to the meeting, but if you have people who need free lodging, I'd be happy to host them at our nearby place. And they did. And they sent me a Greek and a Turk. but it worked out fine. The one thing I wanted to mention to you is I have prepared some time ago a booklet called The Conservative Organizational Entrepreneur for people who are creating nonprofit organizations, conservative or libertarian, and its guidance within the United States about how to form such a group. My Leadership Institute last year trained 25,600 people. 15,000 of them were abroad. We do a lot of training abroad, and while some of the stuff in the booklet has to do with the legal structure of a nonprofit in the United States, there's other information here that I hope you will find useful, and I've brought, I think, enough copies of this little brochure for all of you. It also exists in its entirety on the Leadership Institute website, leadershipinstitute.org. Thank you.
Just as a quick note, Morton has worked mostly with conservatives, but they did a market study recently. The largest segment now that they serve is the libertarian market. More than 30% of the students that attend the programs classify themselves as libertarian. The next speaker is our good friend Barbara Kohn from Austria. Barbara.
Thank you, Alex, and thank you, Atlas, to put this together as an addition to the MPS to get the think tanks together and work. As you all know, we have done our homework in Europe doing the networking as hard as it is sometimes, but if we don't only preach the division of labor but get it done, then we can see success. And what the Austrian Economic Center and the Hayek Institute in Vienna do is we have free products, three things that many of you have done in other ways, but freedom is intangible and we need to create a tangible good. And one of the tangible goods we have done is the Free Market Roadshow, and it's now in existence for 8 years. We started out with 4 capitals. This year we exceeded 30 capitals. Next year, in Europe, the Caucasus region. Next year it will be a little bit more. We might touch at 35. We'll see how logistics works. again, we're a small team, and it's always challenging for everybody, but it is a good sign for the other side, for the well-meaning people, that there are strong think tanks around, and the secret of the success is that our local partners are the ones who are the heroes, because they line up with their businesses, with the journalists, with the students for liberty, with whoever is engaged in the respective country. So this is one product that we have done, and I want to let you know that it can be done if you continue and never give up. And then this is the way how things grow, and we will start with our first roadshow stop in the United States this year, just only one stop at Texas Tech University, November 11th. Whoever is around, join us. We're excited to discuss and bring this concept over here. But again, this is only possible if we divide labor and if we cooperate. And what you have been doing here, Alex and Brad, and you know the entire Atlas team, I think this is important that we share our knowledge and divide this, and never be jealous of each other. Our enemies are way too strong and too big in order that we can afford, you know, not walking the same line and not being on the freeway and racing the fire to our goal with 80 miles per hour. Now I'll keep it at that, and thank you.
Barbara, do you know the dates of the European roadshow?
Of course. Well, we start out April 15th, 2015. And it will be until the European Resource Bank meeting, which, if you have not heard yet, which will be held in Istanbul in May this year, next year, 2015. But we will, of course, challenge all the information via all our networks.
And Barbara is a frequent participant in the International Wednesday Coalition meetings, where I think at the end of December, from December until starts, and during when it's going on, we use it to promote her work. Now, if any of you knows of a talented speaker, or yourself are a talented speaker, and you're going to be in Europe, please offer your services to Barbara, because she does this in a very cost-effective manner, and having people who are already in Europe, you know, volunteering to speak, you know, I think would greatly help. So thank you, Barbara. Our next speaker from Switzerland is Pierre Bessard, president of the Liberal Institute. Pierre.
Thank you. It's nice to be among friends coming from one of the more difficult places in Europe. To give you some brief background, the Liberal Institute is a non-profit, tax-exempt, 100% a privately funded foundation. It's been running for 35 years, and I've been heading it for the last 7 years, since late 2007. We have operations mainly in French and German in the Lake Geneva region and in Zurich, and a little bit in Italian, in Ticino. It's a complicated country. We do work that you can expect from a principal free market think tank, with regular publications and events communicating and advancing our ideas. And our focus is mainly fundamental, long-term ideas and less immediate policy. And this morning I'd like to share our latest work on Europe, more specifically on the European heritage of institutional diversity and competition, the multiplication of open jurisdictions, or the absence of centralization as a crucial but much underrated advantage in Europe. And to some extent, this work has been going on forever at the Institute, since we have always opposed Switzerland's entry into the European Union for that very reason. And our more recent work will culminate with a book that I am editing and contributing to, with the involvement of some of the best scholars on the issue, such as Erich Wede, who is in this room, Ralph Rako, Philippe Nemo, Roland Faubel, Pascal Salin, Michael Wolgemuth, Philippe Bagus, and many others. And our aim is to reclaim the word Europe from the European Union, from the Eurocrats, and the centralizing politicians. And we do this not from the standpoint of a national sovereignty agenda, but from the standpoint of an individual sovereignty, an individual freedom and responsibility agenda. And I hope to be able to present this book at a second project of ours, a gala evening on October 31st that I am hosting together with Fred Hoeder of European Students for Liberty in Berlin, and where we intend to celebrate the 25th anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall from the perspective of individual freedom rather than social democracy, which we'll probably hear a lot about. And you are welcome to attend this gala evening if you are in the region. The website is libertyinberlin.org, libertyinberlin, one word, .org, and the gala evening will benefit the Stasi Museum in Berlin, just as a reminder or a warning of what could happen with the European Union in the future, you know, spying on their citizens, whether they have eaten their vegetables and doing their daily exercise. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Pierre. Our next speaker is Fariza Ibrahim. Is Fariza here? From the IDEAS, which is launching a project in October called the Southeast Asia Network for Development. Fariza, thank you for joining us.
Hello, my name is Fariza. I work for IDEAS. Some of you may know OneCircle. We are launching a new project. It's called CNET, Southeast Asia Network for Development. We're launching it in October, and we'll have an event at the EFN in Hong Kong in November. The reason I'm speaking to you is two reasons. First is that we've got this four-year IDEAS review that I put up at the registration table, so if you're interested to know a bit more about the work that IDEAS does, please grab a copy. The second reason is we've got an introduction document for CNET. I've got about 20 copies if you're interested to learn a little bit more about the work that CNET's hoping to do in property rights, inclusive growth, as well as freer movement of goods and people in Southeast Asia. Please grab a copy for me. We're looking for comments. And the second one is that we're actually looking for partners around the region. So if you have questions, do come over and say hi to Trisha or myself, and we'll be happy to share a bit more about CNET with you. Thank you.
Now is the turn for one of our great friends, and apart from being such a generous supporter of economic freedom, Ron Manners has the talent of always being happy, always being positive. So I think we need to have more Ron Manners examples around the free market, libertarian world. So, Ron Manners.
Thank you, Alex, and good friends. And let me thank the Atlas Network and the Lion Rock Institute for creating this opportunity for us to spend time together. I think it's most important. Now, my name is Ron Manners, and I'm from the Mancal Foundation, which is an Australian think tank. So please don't leave today without a copy of one of our publications like this. Just think that you are taking with you a taste of Australia. Now, in our 17 years of existence, we've developed something of a niche, a main function that we're doing apart from the events and the normal stuff. We're exposing young people to the free market. And we've done this by sponsoring a few events like this today. And this week we've had 650 young people all together have this experience. And today I've been joined for the whole week with the Montpellier Society with six remarkable young people. I'd just like them to stand together, if I may. We've got Alex Dixon, Christopher Vu, Rohi Kalia, Marcus Hamilton, and Matthew Bunny and Kelly Wong. A great team, and they've behaved themselves exemplary during the weekend and set a wonderful example for me. Now, I think it was Aristotle that that said that nature abhors a vacuum. And in a similar fashion, our Mancal Foundation abhors the vacuum left by, particularly by most Australian universities, by not even mentioning the power and the creativity of the free market. It's just missing. It's that dimension's missing. So that's what we're trying to do, stimulate people with that power, the power of the market, and its ability to lift all of these wonderful people on this great world in which we live. Now, it's a little bit like the old Pareto theorem, you know, where 20% of your effort creates 80% of the real meaningful results. I think there's even a better multiplier with the free market, so that really is 10% of your effort can create 90% contribution to your own lives. And it's our wish that there's a lasting effect by this exposure to the free market, and I know that in my case it's made all the difference to my own life. Thank you.
Thank you, Ron. And again, Perth is far away for many of us, but if you get to go to the wonderful part of the world, real great western part of Australia, he will make you feel tremendously at home and introduce you to an outstanding group of people fighting for freedom in that part of Australia. Thank you, Ron. Our next speaker is also from the business side, a great businesswoman, also always happy, I think because she's out of her country often. You know, Margaret said, who works in beautiful Brazil, Instituto Liberdade. So, Margaret, also a great joyful champion of freedom. Can you come? Margaret said.
Good morning to all. I represent Instituto Liberdade from Brazil, and it was created in 1986, and we are headquartered inside the Pontifical Catholic University at the Science and Technology Park. Our major activities involve the promotion of the Tax Freedom Day, and also the promotion of courses and seminars, like our last week we had a course of law and economics for magistrates, and we published books. The last one was the Virtue of Selfishness from Ayn Rand. And also we are co-partners of another institute in Brazil called Institute of Entrepreneurial Studies to organize the Brazilian Liberty Fund. Thank you.
And most of the people in South Brazil are free market friends, are Randian, so it's amazing, you know, how things change that you can be lodged at the Pontifical Catholic University. They're also the largest event in the year for free market friends is the Liberty Forum that takes place at the same university organized by the Institute for Entrepreneurial Studies. It usually takes place the second week of April, a very busy week, but approximately 6,000 people attend that program. So if you want to attend Brazil, try to do it the second week of April and attend that fantastic program. Her institute really collaborates very well with the Institute of Entrepreneurial Studies. Our next speaker will go to a different continent, Blaszej Moller from Poland. Blaszej.
Hello, everybody. So I was asked to tell a few things about Poland first, and then our activity at Civil Development Forum Foundation, which is based in Warsaw, is the biggest free market think tank in our country. So in Poland, everything what is going on right now in political and life and economic activity, everything is in the shadow of the conflict in our neighbor country, Ukraine. We have war in this country. And we can observe it is one of the major public issues in Polish media, in Polish politics, and in Polish public opinion. So we can observe that there will be also shift in economic terms, because there are more and more proposals to increase our military budget and prepare for eventual military conflict in the future. So there will be also a big change on the political scene in Poland because current Prime Minister was elected the President of the European Council. He's been a Prime Minister for the past 7 years. And he's leaving his office within the next few weeks, and he will become the President of the European Council in December. This is the highest European position which has ever been held by the politician from the Eastern Europe, and the Polish position on Ukraine, on conflict with the Kremlin regime is very tough, and I think it is an important issue. In terms of activity at the Civil Development Forum, our biggest campaign was related to the defense of the pension system. In Poland, since more than 15 years, we had a diverse pension system, which was a little bit similar to the one in Chile. Unfortunately, the government decided to take away money from the private pension funds and move it to the state pension funds. And there was a big debate, a big campaign. Private pension funds were not allowed to advertise themselves. At the end, government decided that people can choose in which pension funds they want to be, and it was a very, unfortunately, anti-free market campaign. The government allowed people to choose only for a very short period of time, about 3 weeks, and it was in the middle of holidays. And if people wanted to sign up to the private pension funds, they had to fill up the application. And our think tank was the strongest advocate of the free, the private pension funds and possibility to choose. 16 million people had a chance to choose, and at the end of July, 2.5 million people decided to keep their pension in the private pension funds. So we think it was a big success, and the government was very disappointed in this issue. So we keep our activity at Poland, and thank you, Atlas, for all the support.
Thank you, Blażej, and all the Polish freedom fighters that really keep on a good fight, and I'm looking forward to visit with you September 18th, so thank you for organizing that, Blażej. Our next speaker is Randy Teague, the chairman of the Fund for American Studies, which has a different mission than Atlas, but similar views, and also they do a lot of programs around the world, and despite their name, they really respect the local culture, incorporating talented speakers from each place where they operate on that program. Randy.
Thank you. The Fund for American Studies is not a fund, and we don't do American studies. Other than that, it was founded by Charles Edison, Thomas Edison's son, in 1967. And now we are at George Mason University, where we do programs for university students from throughout the United States and the world community. We have programs in Prague for Central and Eastern Europe and part of the Middle East, Santiago for Latin America, and here in Hong Kong at Hong Kong University for Asia. We reach about 1,000 students each year in the United States and around the world. Since Mount Clarence Society met the last time for its general meeting, we have acquired the Foundation for Teaching Economics, based in San Francisco, a 30-plus year program at the high school level, because we believe that you have to reach them at that level to be better prepared to defend freedom at the university level. And we have begun our first postgraduate program, which is in law, and that's at Georgetown University in Washington, taught by people that believe in the sanctity of the Constitution of the United States. So that is what we are about. And what we need from you is to send us students. Go into the Fund website or DC internship website and send us students for a program in the United States. We have scholarships, never enough. That's true with any organization, I suppose. But we do have scholarship monies for the students, both for the programs in Washington and overseas. My closing comment is, and I was sharing this with someone from Atlas before we began this morning is that if you ever think about not coming to an Atlas function, whether here or in New York each year in November, etc., you always want to come, because if there's anything that really charges your batteries, is realizing how incredibly growing and strong this movement is globally. That none of us in our nation stand alone in this. It is truly a worldwide effort, and it is so great to come and listen to reports like this. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Randy, for your generous word and generosity that you express in many actions and collaboration with many groups. Our next speaker is Vice President of Reason by Julian Morris. I think can be described as a superb think tank in himself. Julian, thank you.
Thank you very much, Alex. I should actually like to thank Alex, who helped give me my start in the international think tank movement. I was an intern in 1994 at the Atlas Foundation and got to meet many great people who helped me establish my vision and get me started on the road to various different activities. Many of you will know me in association with a previous role that I had as running a group called International Policy Network. In the past 3 years, I've been with the Reason Foundation. I'll quickly give you an overview of what Reason is and does, if you don't know. Reason was founded in 1968 as a magazine, and its motto is Free Minds, Free Markets, and it stresses both those elements strongly. Last time I was in Hong Kong, I met someone at a business meeting. He mentioned that he was able to obtain Reason on a newsstand in Hong Kong, so clearly it's available around the world in some measure, but I think it's most easily available to all of you through the internet. So reason.com is our website. We have about 3 million visitors a month. We talk about an enormous range of issues. Many of them are focused on domestic issues in the US, but there are some international issues too. We, in addition to the significant focus on communicating libertarian ideas through our media platform like Reason.com and Reason.tv, where we have an exceedingly large range of videos. We produce about a video a day and have about a million views of our videos a month. In addition to those platforms, we also have a think tank. In contrast to the magazine and the video parts of Reason, which focus on a very wide range of libertarian ideas and communicating those ideas to a wide audience, the think tank focuses primarily on state and local government reform. So we have a particular focus this year on pension reform in the United States, as in many other parts of the world. Governments at the national, state, and local level have established pensions that are defined benefits. So they give people money at the end of their working life in proportion, usually, to the amount of income that those people have been receiving during the course of their life. This is, it turns out, unsustainable when you have aging populations. And changing structures of the workforce. So we're working very hard now to encourage state and local governments to move from that system of pensions to defined contribution schemes. These are like the private schemes that Blaise mentioned that we have in Chile and elsewhere, successful in many cases. We're in that context, we're producing a variety of case studies which could be useful for those of you who are interested in seeking to transform your own pension systems from the kind of defined benefit schemes to defined contribution schemes, because they give insights, I think, into how one overcomes obstacles. You know, for example, unions are very often a significant obstacle to reform, by demonstrating or giving examples of the kinds of reforms that have taken place in various different parts of the US, I think it's helpful in looking at how those reforms can be overcome. I'd be interested in also learning about the experiences of similar reforms around the world. Maybe we could produce case studies of those other sorts of reforms. We're also engaged in other areas which will probably be familiar to many of you, such as education reform, pushing for choice in education. We have, I think unusually though, for a think tank, a very significant focus on transportation policy. So Gordon will be founded recently, has become one of the leading experts around the world in how to move transportation systems from being entirely sort of centrally planned government-run schemes to involve more and more private sector. And that ranges from privatization of airports to private road building and tolling, these kinds of things. In that context, we actually had a project in China where we were seeking to advocate for reform for a shift towards private building and operation of roads in one city in China. We managed to choose Chongqing, which turns out to have been a bit of a mistake, so rather given problems with Bo Xilai. But we nevertheless we've done a study in China, and we have data and a report which we would like to communicate. So if there are folks here from China who are interested in communicating the results of that report more widely, then I'd be interested in talking to you. And I think it may also have implications for other countries around the world. That was at least the hope. So that's a very quick overview. I'd be very happy to discuss all of that and other things with you separately. Are our email addresses and other things going to be circulated?
I think we
can do that. Okay, that'll be great. So anyway, so I'm happy for everyone to know mine, which is julian.morris@reason.org. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Julian. And the newsletter that Bob Poole produces on transportation reform is really a gold mine for anyone working in the field. It's a key area of any economy. So I recommend that you subscribe to his newsletter. I think it's free. The next speaker, just very short, another coalition effort that overlaps a little bit with some of our network. Mark Klugman, you want to say a few words about the Property Rights Alliance?
Hi, my name is Mark Kleidman. My larger activity is with the Honduran Leap Zones, but when I'm in the United States, I'm a member of the Americans for Tax Reform Foundation Board, and one of those projects is the Property Rights Alliance, and I realize that a number of the organizations that are here collaborate with that, and that's very important work. And in Lorenzo Montanari, in producing the annual report this year, will have a case study that I've prepared regarding property rights reform using a different instrument, which is the Leap Zones model, which I think is an interesting complementary tool. So please take a look at that and consider whether that can be useful as a second tool in your toolkit, which up to now generally has one tool on that issue. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. I will ask Jose Cordero from Venezuela to just a quick word about the 30th anniversary of CEDICE. I think that also was good ties with
Mopedran. Yes, I'm Jose, originally from Venezuela, even though I had to change citizenship because you probably know the horrible situation in my country, in Venezuela, really horrible. Venezuela is always in the bottom 10 in all the indexes, property rights, freedom, corruption. But the good news is that we celebrated 30 years and Alex was there, also Nobel laureate Mario Vargas Llosa. We had an incredible event, but just a few meters outside there were 300 students camping, protesting for freedom, and actually 50 of them have been massacred. I don't know if you read that, but the government actually sent paramilitary troops and 50 students were killed in Caracas in the last few months. So it's a horrible situation, really horrible. Some of the directors of CEDICE, they actually have orders of arrest and things like that. Our general manager, Rocio Guijarro, every time she travels, she has to ask for a special permission to leave the country, and she has to report every month to the government to tell them what she's doing. It's really horrible. So if you want to learn more about Venezuela and the tragedy of Venezuela, I'll be happy to tell you the horrible situation we are living in my country. Thank you.
Thank you, Jose Luis. usually towards the end of the program we ask people to share with us, you know, the dates of their major programs, you know, that might be of interest for any the international family of freedom lovers. So I will start with our CEO, Brad Litt, who will share with you the programs that Atlas is doing, and then if you want to share with us the dates of your program, please go.
Thank you very much, Alex. I just wanted to make sure that everybody is grabbing the materials that we have, in part because I think they're very informative, in part because we don't want to carry them home. There's some dates you should know about. You've all seen this. We're really privileged, Alex, to be involved in the organizing of the next general meeting of McLaren Society, which will be in Miami in September of 2016. So hope that you're already making plans to be with us at that time. So it should be a really exciting and diverse meeting. We're making a big effort to get a lot of younger scholars as well to bring some extra energy to the MPS proceedings that year. On the little handout you have today that has our program for today, if you look on the reverse side, we have a little save the date for something called the Asia Liberty Forum that we've been running the last couple of years in New Delhi. This year will be in Kathmandu, January of 2015. This is similar to Atlas's Liberty Forum, which I will plug next, but with a focus on our Asian partners. It's run by the Asian Center for Enterprise, which is a joint project of Atlas and Center for Civil Society, represented here by Parth Shah. And increasingly, we're also involved with Samriddhi from Nepal in running this important effort to try to spread the network in Asia. On the reverse side of our annual report, we also have the dates for the meeting that Randy Teague so generously plugged, the Atlas Liberty Forum, which is our biggest networking meeting of the year. And I think it really is like a great complement to the value proposition that you get here at Mount Pelerin. If the Mount Pelerin Society is the premier gathering of intellectuals, I think that Atlas is maybe less theory, but more applied science, more of taking these conversations to the very practical challenges of how do we now advance the ideas, get them into the bloodstream of real policy discussions in different countries around the world. So November 12th and 13th in New York City is one of the most energizing Liberty conferences you will attend. Well, just a couple of the things that will happen there. We have the announcement of the Templeton Freedom Award, the biggest prize that goes to honor the excellent work of think tanks connected to the Atlas Network. This year we have a tribute to John Blundell, our late board member, a friend of so many in this room. I know that John's wife Chris is very happy that a lot of his international friends will be together for what will be a really special evening, the first night of our two-day program. And then we are in the second year of a lecture program in honor of Leonard Liggio, past president of the Mount Pelerin Society and our longtime executive vice president. Now 81 years old, and his health is such that he can't do any international traveling, but we're so happy that he's going to be able to attend in person in New York. So there's more details about that program at atlasnetwork.org. The website's been revamped, and I think that you'll find that there's not only information on Atlas-run events, but also partner events. So send us what you're doing, because it's becoming a really great place to advertise your work. And while you're there, sign up for our World 10 newsletter, which comes out every 2 weeks, plugging the 10 most interesting things that we're aware of in the worldwide freedom movement. So that's the Atlas plug.
I saw Enrique Gersi, who is the head of the organizing committee for the Mount Pelerin meeting that's going to take place in Lima, March 22nd to 25th. Mount Pelerin is by nomination only, but then, you know, where many members present here can invite you to attend. Ian Vasquez there sitting at the table during the program committee, correct?
Yes.
So any question you might have about that program, please ask us. It's an easy place to fly to, so I hope many of you will come. There's another think tank present here with one of our board members, Instituto Libertad y Desarrollo from Chile, has become also a training center for think tanks in different parts of Latin America. Atlas is going to have a training program the first week of October in Santiago. and then the 25th anniversary of that think tank will take place in Chile somewhere between mid-October and the beginning of November. So again, I think that's another good date to keep in mind. Any of you have any announcement for any future program? Then I think Barbara Kuhn.
Just one more add-on. 28th of October this year, we will give the Hayek Lifetime Achievement Award to Deirdre McCloskey in Vienna. And Pierre just pointed out the conference in Berlin, 31st. So maybe, and there will be a conference in Austrian Economics Finance, 29th of October. So if you want to come over, it's worth flying from Berlin to Vienna and vice versa. And you can catch two good events,
of course. Let's see, Julian, then.
Yeah, just quick. If you do come to New York for the Atlas events in the week of the 10th of November, the Reason Foundation is hosting a Reason Media Awards on the 10th, and we'd be delighted to host as many of you as we can fit in the room.
Peter Wong, Lion Rock Institute. In 2012, we co-hosted the EFN, Economic Freedom Network, conference in Hong Kong because it was so good, so successful, so we are going to do it again this year. November 6th to 7th, we will have the Financial Secretary of Hong Kong, John Zhang, who will be our keynote speaker there. And at the same time, we will have highlights on the economic freedom reports produced by Fraser. We have a study about it, and then also the conference, we will have friends over 100 coming together. So if you are interested joining us, please do so. We'll have some flyers outside, so you may get it. For more information, feel free to contact me. Thank you.
Palmer.
A quick note on behalf of our Ukrainian friends who can't be here because they're rather busy at the moment, but not giving up, and November 29 and 30 in Kiev will be a libertarian summit, and then we're hoping in Kharkiv immediately after, and depending on what Mr. Putin does, in Donetsk. So they're sticking with the course.
Well, thank you so much, and hopefully we'll put all these dates on our website. Atlas revamped the website, and it's really good looking and easy to navigate. So take a look there and share your key dates with us. The next session will begin at 10:30 in the Rose and Peony Room, located next door here. So again, thank you to all our supporters. We couldn't do this. Many people wouldn't be here if it wouldn't be for you. So thank you for all that you do for freedom, and we'll continue working for freedom next door. Thank you.